Hi, my name is Glory. I'm a second year student studying at the Bartlett School of Architecture in London, originally from Hong Kong.
And I'm Yanshan, a second year architecture student, and I'm into musicals, oil painting, movies, and embarrassingly into self-help and Ritchie Biscuits.
You're listening to Designing Thoughts with the Archigals, a podcast where we talk about working and creativity, living well, the human condition with relationships and life experiences. Before we get into the podcast, I would just like to ask for a small favor. It would mean a lot to us if you could leave us a review on Apple Podcasts or leave a comment on our YouTube channel just to let us know how you feel about the podcast and other topics you'd be interested in hearing in. Hi everyone, welcome back to our podcast. So today we have a special guest today and she's with me. So her name is Nicole and today we're going to be talking about kind of like her research journey because she's studying biochemistry at UCL. Well, she's going to do a short introduction to herself later, but we're going to be talking about like her research journey at school and then how that helped her develop as a person and then something related to gut health and also just kind of linking that to intuition, kind of like listening to your gut. So Nicole, you can do a short introduction to yourself.
Hi everyone. So as Gloria said, my name is Nicole and I study biochemistry at UCL. And I'm very interested into gut health and I've also done some research experience this summer. So we're going to talk about this for a bit. And I'm really excited to be on this podcast with Gloria and Yanshan. So let's go.
Cool. Thank you so much, Nicole. So I guess the first thing we can talk about is, well, I guess kind of where are you from and like why are you interested in biochemistry?
So I'm originally from Germany. And I was very interested in science. So during my high school years, I started reading books on science. For instance, I contain Multitudes from Ed Yong, which was very interesting for me, which was on microbes, basically. So I got like really interested into the gut microbiome and how it relates to our health and how it is linked to so many different diseases. I went to studying biochemistry at UCL, which I really enjoy.
That's great.
So I guess it's like quite interesting that you came from Germany to go to UCL. Did you choose it specifically because of like the course structure there and like the teaching or the professors?
I wanted to apply my English, which was part of it. And then the other thing is the university structure is different to universities in Germany. Mm-hmm. And I really liked the system from what I got from my research, I guess, of British universities. And then obviously UCL is so big and it just offers so many opportunities. And I personally love the diversity and meeting people from all around the world, which is just great.
That's cool. And I know you talked about like really liking science, but like obviously compared to like high school, science was more about like absorbing information rather than like research. So how would you say like research is different to like just, you know, absorbing information from lectures and reading off textbooks?
Yeah, I guess research is different in the sense that at least like from my experience, right? I'm just talking here from my personal experience. It's just you have to be on top of the topic all the time, like reading research papers, what's new in the literature, because the field is moving rapidly, and you have to like think which way do you want to move and like really critically assess like what experiments you want to do to like advance in this field. So it's different in that sense that it's like very unknown, but I quite like that because you can then just, you know, think about it yourself and kind of move the topic in the direction and just, you know, get new findings, new results that no one has ever done before.
That's actually pretty cool because, I mean, obviously, as people know, like Yanshan and I do architecture. So obviously for us, like research has a different meaning. I think for us, research is more about like, you know, obviously also reading literature, but it's kind of like obviously also thinking critically and like having different viewpoints and stuff when you apply that to your design projects. Do you think like with regarding, because obviously for yours is like more scientific compared to us, which is like more theory and humanities based. So would you say like for you, the research is a lot like fact based and you kind of enjoy the idea that a lot of it is facts based? Like, you know, that if you do this research, then the outcome would be this and you have like a concrete set of
results type of thing? Because I'm not sure how it works in like a science lab, obviously.
Right. So I guess it is more like results based and facts based. You're more rational in that sense. But quite often you get results that you don't expect. And then you think about it, why is that? And like, what went wrong? So it's much more like the gray area. It's not like either white or black. So
yeah, like I think like from what you explained about research, I was always struck by how like creative it sounded and also how risky it was. I think in my mind, it kind of like, oh, you just do research means that you carry out this experiment, you know how, like you have a hypothesis and you're just trying to prove the hypothesis. But a lot of time, like you're also trying to get the right hypothesis by understanding what's already around and then trying to come up with like a creative way to run the experiment. And like a lot of unexpected things happen. I'm just always, I think when I heard you speak about like the research, like how an experiment is run, it just seems so much more creative and interesting than I
imagine. Yeah, that's actually what I was thinking about that, because Nicole was talking to me about how like when you run an experiment, you actually need like creativity to know like how to run it and then like what type of things you have to do. And I was like, oh, I never like associate creativity with like running experiments, you know, because I guess creativity is always related to like so-called creative practices, like art related, like years and stuff. So that was like what I was familiar with, and then like seeing her apply that to like experiments, like that was really cool.
Yeah, because you're also like making new things, like you're making new contributions to the field.
Yeah,
and really,
do you have anything to add with like creativity and
I think that's quite true, and people like often assume it's like very, you know, science results based, and like you have to think a lot, but I guess what I like is also the like scientific discussions in between the experiments, where you like think what can we do next and which is like the best way to go, and then you try things out and then you optimize them, which also like involves like talking to a lot of people who are experts to to optimize the experiments so that you can do them better. And it's quite interesting because you can also like try things out and fail and then try them differently. So it is quite creative.
But does it, do you think that this work is like impactful for you? I guess it's like, why do you want to go into research? Especially knowing that it's always like at the start of the process, like by the time it reaches a consumer, like a pharmaceutical drug or something, it's always like many, many years down the line. So the impact is quite spread out.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I'm very at the beginning of my scientific career. And now I've only seen the side of academia so far, which is kind of basic science, but it does relate to the clinic and to patients. When like I saw people getting like patient samples and analyzing those, so that is quite interesting. But obviously in industry it's a bit different, so you can actually see how a drug or like a medicine is developed and how it actually relates to the world, which I think is like really great.
Yeah, super cool.
Do you think like at UCL you kind of see that process, or like is it very different, you know, at university compared to, I guess, more in industry, like drug making stuff? I don't know how it works.
Yeah, I mean, as part of my course, we do labs, but obviously that's not research. It's just for us to learn techniques and learn how to do experiments. So like during my summer I did an internship, and so I worked in the lab, and that is quite different because you're actually immersed into the research group and you're like a part of it, and you feel like a real scientist for the first time, and it's quite a cool feeling knowing that there's like so much unknown and you're trying to contribute to finding new knowledge.
Well, I guess since you spoke about a research experience, you could elaborate more on like how you got it and how it was like and how long it was, that kind of thing.
Yeah. So I did it for like almost 10 weeks this summer. And basically, I was looking at the intestinal epithelial barrier. So this is basically a single cell layer in the gut that separates the host like tissue, like the human tissue, from the microbes. And we were treating it with different molecules to see if the structure of the cells changes, because in many diseases, the gut is what's so-called leaky gut. So the barrier is disrupted and then things and microbes can pass through. So we were looking at this like integrity of the cells.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said, I was immersed in this research group, which was a great experience. And I worked closely with a PhD student. So he did that kind of like in his project, and I helped him and learned from him the techniques. Because obviously, because of COVID, we didn't really have labs during second year. So.
Right. So this is like your first hands-on experience this year.
Yeah, exactly. And we grew intestinal cell lines.
That's so cool.
Which was really very interesting for me because I've never done that before.
Then you had to like control the. So you were in charge of like, I guess you were just like the helper assistant. So like whatever they were doing, you just helped out. Even with like writing reports and stuff.
I mean, no, I wasn't really the helper. It was more really like I felt included in the research group, and decisions were made like together. So it was kind of, we were working together. And obviously he showed me how to do things, but I think what really helped me after a while was that he had confidence in me doing the things. Like he saw that I could do them. And so then he left me alone and I could just do things for us.
That's so nice that he gave you like the
responsibility.
Yeah, the responsibility to do it.
Yeah.
Are research clusters usually set up that way though? So it's like a professor and then a PhD student and then like a couple of assistants?
Or... I mean, usually you have a principal investigator, which is usually, I think, a postdoc. But this research group, I guess, was kind of different because we didn't, like, they don't have a postdoc at the moment. So it's mainly the PhD students. It's quite a small one as well. So
So a postdoc is someone who has already done their PhD?
Yeah, exactly. And
all right. Wasn't... So also you didn't have a postdoc, it was just a PhD student like running the show, kind of.
The show, yeah.
This is probably a really stupid question, but then like how do you get the cells from the gut? Like how do you get it?
It's like a cancer cell line, which was taken from a cancer patient at some point. And then because the cancer cells, they just, they divide and new cells emerge all the time. So the cell line doesn't die. And then you can just get it from like a manufacturer, like a pharmaceutical, like not a pharmaceutical company, but just a company, and you order the cells and then you grow them.
Oh,
yeah. Okay. And then it's like a pet.
Oh, so you just buy it.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so cool. I thought you had to like harvest it.
No. You buy it and then you have to like change the, what's called the medium. It's like what the cells are in. So it's like with the nutrients, so that they don't die. And you like caring for them, and then you have to like split them when they're like too many cells in one flask, and then you
run experiments on them to like see what happens. I guess what was like the aim of the research? Was it just to see how the gut is affected when you have cancer?
No, so basically we were looking at the effect of like specific molecules on the barrier.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it sounds like you had so much fun over the summer, honestly. Like, even though I don't completely understand the cell things, but, like, it just sounds really cool and you get to, like, interact with different people. And I know it's, like, a new experience for you compared to, like, you know, before you came to London, and also a new thing, you know, before year one and year two. So how would you say that this helped you, I guess, develop your interest or, like, kind of, you yourself as a person, you know, doing all this research and like learning so much stuff?
Yeah, so I think on the one hand, it's kind of confirmed for me personally that I do want to do research after my degree, because I was a bit scared that, oh, you know, during second year, I didn't have any lab experience. What if this is not what I want to do anymore? Mm-hmm. So this was just great because I really enjoyed myself. And then also, I feel like it was kind of a boost of confidence in a way, because, as I said, I felt like a real researcher and contributor to the group, and it just gives you like more responsibility. And then after all those weeks, you realize that, oh, actually, I was able to do all of this. And I feel like I became more confident in doing things and also thinking critically about experiments, We had lots of lab meetings, sitting there for 3 hours and just like, talking about the science and what that could mean. And yeah,
I can imagine how interesting those are, though, like, because all of you are contributing and like giving ideas to like what this type of findings might mean. But yeah, I think it's really nice that you found out that this is something you like, you know. I think Yanshan and I also talked about this back then, like, it doesn't matter if you like it or you don't like it, because either way you gain information to like how you function and what your likes are as a person. But yeah, I'm just really glad that it worked out for you, because I remember during summer you were just going to the lab every single day, and even when I came to London you're like, yeah, I'm going to the lab today. I'm like, oh, I'm so glad that Nicole found what she likes doing, you know.
So I guess because to me it's like strange that while you actually enjoy like going to the lab and having long meetings and talking about science, because it's like, why would you want to do that?
I think it's the same thing for architecture. Probably Nicole would see us and be like, why would you guys, how can you go into the studio like every single day and work for long hours on like a single project?
Yeah, I guess it's the same. It's just the interest. And
yeah,
it's not as if we're like in the actual lab like 24/7, right? It's mainly you do some things and you look after the cells, and then you kind of sit in the office and you just do literature chit-chat. And
Right.
Not really chit-chat, you do work.
I did a lot of chit-chatting in the studio, but so that chit-chat.
Yeah, but that's also included, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Do you like that do you wish that, like, what's one thing you would change about it? Like, do you wish there'd be, like, a bit more human interaction or a bit more, recognition or something in the field?
Yeah, I mean, just from my experience, because of COVID, obviously there weren't many people in the lab at all. So it was like I was surrounded by the same people every day, kind of. And I think it's quite nice, like, if COVID wasn't there, like, during my experience, right? I think I would have met much, like, more people, more scientists, more PhD students, and I could have talked, like, to them about their experience. But nonetheless, I'm like very grateful that I had the opportunity, because not everyone had the opportunity to be in the lab. And and I met like different PhD students, and they gave me advice, and I just talked to them about their projects and what they are doing, which was great.
So do you think you would, I guess, what comes after this generally, if you're like in wanting to go into academia, is it common after this to immediately go to try to get a PhD? So you have to get sponsored by uni to do a PhD, I guess, or is it, or do people usually do their masters? And
so usually you do a master's degree, but I know that in the UK you can go immediately to do your PhD. Although I mean, I have no idea how hard it is to like secure one with that, I guess, little research experience. I know that some people have done it, but yeah, it just depends, I guess.
Oh, and so I guess that after that, do people usually try to get tenure? Is that your goal, by the way, to get tenure at a university, to become a professor?
I know that I want to do research, but I'm not entirely sure what exactly I'm going to do next, like, after my bachelor. And at some point, I feel like I want to see how working in industry is.
Right.
Because you're getting kind of more multidisciplinary research, and you're also seeing, I think, I'm
like
not so
real
sure
life
if that's
impact.
True. Yeah, exactly. So, I'm not sure like what exactly, which direction I want to go yet. But I know that I do want to do research. So.
Yeah, I think it's just interesting to me, because like as someone who does architecture, there's not a lot that I think I'm doing after uni other than becoming an architect or like leaving. And by leaving, not going into science at all, like to do like something humanities related. So I guess it's like so interesting to see that like in the science field as well, there's lots of uncertainty about where you want to end up and where you can go.
Yeah, I mean, apart from research, like what other career paths can you take?
Industry. You could go into like a pharmaceutical.
Yeah, you can.
I feel like quite a lot of people also go into like business and consulting.
Yeah, that's true. You can like consult for different companies on health stuff related. Yeah, or like even science journalism.
So, I guess we can talk about your, but we did talk about like your research like into gut health, if you have anything else to add to that, like I guess kind of like your findings, like if you're happy to share it, or like kind of just I guess things you learn doesn't necessarily have to be scientific, but also how, like if it applied to like your daily life with like the research, you know.
Right. I think mainly like reading a lot of literature is already like I guess shaping how I view gut health. Because as I said, the gut microbiome, which is like basically all of the bacteria, the fungi, viruses living in your gut, like taken together, they impact health because like the majority of the immune system is actually in your gut. So it's like very interesting for me to see the interactions between how the gut microbiome primes the immune system, and quite often in diseases like the gut microbiome composition is kind of upset, or like you can have pathogens like dominating your gut. So I find it very interesting how you can like restore that balance and like shape it towards health. And in general, like my personal opinion is that I think we can prevent a lot of diseases, hopefully, by like nutrition and like a good lifestyle in general, like, you know, the general stuff like doing exercise, looking after your mental health, nutrition wise, looking after like your fiber content, because like specific bacteria, they basically, the bacteria, they eat fiber. So this is something we can't digest, which is like polysaccharides. And then they produce like kind of good molecules, which shape your immune system and your health. So it has been shown in studies, yeah, like across different countries of what people are eating and how like their gut health relates to that. Yeah, so my like one of my favorite foods is actually sauerkraut. Well, I'm German, which is like a bit of a cliche.
Oh my gosh, you bought 5 jars of sauerkraut. You know, when I was ordering from Ocado, which is like the supermarket that delivers to your flats, she bought 5 jars of sauerkraut. But
to my right, to my defense, the jars are like tiny. They're tiny.
All right, they're not plus, like the big ones.
Yeah, yeah. Plus,
but I guess it's like how the Koreans eat kimchi, right?
Oh yeah, how Koreans eat kimchi. But she said, I guess it's kind of the same thing. I feel like kimchi is just spicy. Like, they're both sour.
Yeah, I mean, the good thing is that it's called prebiotic. So it's basically the fiber in the white cabbage that's like good for your bacteria because they eat it. Mm-hmm. And then you can see differences in your digestion. At least I can. And it also contains like, you know, live bacteria, which is like probiotics. Yeah, so that's quite good. But obviously, don't take this like as advice, because I'm not a like, healthcare professional. You're not a dietitian, anything, right?
It's less interesting how like your research and your interests shape how you live as well. So like, even your dietary habits, like the fact that you're pescatarian or like that you don't drink a lot, that kind of thing, is like very affected by like your research as well. So it's like really cool to see that it's applicable to your life, at least, even if it like doesn't impact other people's lives.
Yeah, it's actually like quite interesting, because I went pescatarian, which is like I think exactly 3 years ago, and it was like after reading a lot about like nutrition and like gut microbiome for the first time, and then I realized that, oh, you know, I've been eating actually quite like badly in that respect. And I wanted to change that, like, for my own health. And also, obviously, during that time, like, I kind of learned about veganism and like, the how it can impact the environment if we, like, reduce the meat intake and stuff. And I cut out meat from my diet. And I'm really happy that I did that, like, just personally. But yeah, it was one of those like turning points, I guess, in life, because I grew up, because my family eats a lot, like a lot of meat, and it's like very kind of
red meat.
Like, yeah, red meat based, and not steak, but yeah, it like mainly has meat in it. And then, so for me, it was like quite, because I grew up loving it, you know, and now in retrospect, like, I don't like, for me it's no problem, to be honest, to not eat like meat. Obviously I'm still eating fish just for health reasons. But yeah, I definitely don't regret it, and it was actually quite easy
to make the switch.
Could
you explain, like, about the research that prompted you to do that?
Sure. So yeah, so I read this book from Bas Cast. I think he's German. It's like The Diet Compass. I'm not so sure what the exact
translation,
like,
is.
The translation is, yeah. But basically, like, studies have shown how people with, like, eating red meat, how it, like, maybe not predisposes, but it, like, increases risk of, like, cardiovascular disease, mm-hmm. And, like, many different types of diseases in general. And so that's why obviously nutritionists tell you to, like, kind of reduce that. And for me, it was, like, mainly the change to eating more vegetables and
fiber.
Yeah, exactly. And
also just fish, I guess, like seafood.
Yeah, increasing. because fish is different to meat in the respect that it's like different fatty acids, mm-hmm. and
omega 3.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, yeah, I just think it's really nice that you have all of this research to back it up. Like you kind of, you went through it yourself. I mean, obviously it's the same for me, since, like, obviously I'm vegan. So yeah, I think for me also the switch was easy, but I think obviously it's, like, for the both of us, for a lot of people it'll be very difficult. Yeah. But yeah, I think we're also lucky in a way that we found the switch kind of, like, straightforward. Like, we just made the change. But yeah, I think it's just nice that you have the sort of, like, it's all personal to you. Like, you have all of this, like, it's all your personal experience as well, and how your research influenced your, like, diet. Because actually I remember before I talked to a lot of, like, medical students, and even, like, you remember people in the Nutrition Society, like, I talked to them and I said, oh, does studying a lot of, like, nutrition related things actually change how you eat? And they were like, no, like, they actually don't care, you know. I remember talking to this fifth year medical student last year, and she was telling me that she never eats fruit. And like
that's so bad.
Yeah, she's like, I don't like it. And I was like, why? And she's like, I just don't like it. And then at some point she was eating a banana, and I was like, oh, I guess you're, like, trying to eat more fruit, right? She's like, yeah, you know, I'm just eating bananas because it's the easiest fruit to eat, you know. I just peel it and then throw this peel in the trash. But yeah, I think it's just cool that for Nicole, like, it, the research, like, helps, like, she actively, like, analyzes it and see how that can be implemented in her lifestyle, like, you know, compare. But I guess with medicine, med students, like, it's more about, like, solving health problems rather than, like, preventing it. I don't know if I'm correct. I'm just making assumptions.
Yeah, but I feel like hopefully medicine will at some point move into that direction, that we prevent more than we actually, like,
right.
have to treat. Because, like, especially, like, the Western lifestyle, like, we're sitting a lot, we're not moving enough, and all of, like, the diet, you know, all of that, like, fat, fast food, it's just not good for our health. And and when you compare that to, for instance, like, blue zones, that's, like, where communities of people who live kind of the longest on Earth, so they're, like, different, in different countries, and you see that the people are moving, they're, like, part of a close community. And they're, like, you know, they have a good social network, but even, like, in when they're 80, they're still, like, working in their garden and, like, you know, getting their plants out of their own garden to eat. And so hopefully it will at some point move towards prevention more.
Yeah, because actually that's actually, like, I think this summer as well, and also because of COVID, all of us have had to, like, take a step back and, like, think about our mental health and physical health. And there's actually so much good that can come from, like, just caring about yourself more instead of always, like, seeking out new experiences and wanting new things, which I think I was very much like that in first year.
Yeah, I agree. It's the same for me. Like, it's kind of, like, wanting a lot of stuff and never really, like, thinking about it. Yeah, never thinking it through. Like, you just want to go for it. So I guess this actually really nicely links to our next section, because I guess Nicole's was talking about, like, gut health, And then this kind of gave, I guess, Yen Chan and me the idea of like listening to your gut, but like obviously in a more like psychological way, because it's kind of about like intuition and stuff like that. This is like really random. I don't know if you guys think this, but like, do you think gut health is like related to like listening to your gut?
Okay, so I think that my therapist told me that it wasn't not related to gut health though, but related to like listening to your body and your gut and like trusting it to tell you, not to tell you, to like to lead you like in the right direction that your body knows for you. Which sounds very like airy fairy, but I kind of feel like it's kind of true. Like, you know, like if you like think of a decision, then you close your eyes and then you like imagine the two options and like see which one you lean towards. Mm-hmm. Like I was talking to Gloria about this, about how like choosing sometimes, especially for creative pursuits, like even in architecture school, we have this thing called units. So we have to choose our design units, and it's like quite important because it's over half your grade for the entire year. Then you have to choose a unit and you have to choose the right tutors. If not, I mean, not if not, just like choose the one that's right for you.
Yeah.
So that you have a good experience throughout the whole year, because you have it, and then so much of it is just done like intuitively without much like logical or rational decision making.
Yeah, especially because this week we were like selecting units, right? I guess units are essentially tutor groups and they follow a specific theme and approach to design, and sometimes you join because of the tutors, and they release briefs at the beginning of the year that's like 16 units, and you have to make a decision of which one you want to join and then go through an interview for it. And then I think for me and Yen Xiao, we talked about this, like we were just, after we made our decision, and then we were like, yeah, so I selected this unit, and then we were like, do you want to look through our briefs again? And then we realized we didn't even look through the briefs of the units
that we barely read it properly,
but we just kind of felt the atmosphere and vibe of each unit. We're like, yeah, this one suits me, you know. So I think it was kind of us following our gut with like which one to go for. Yeah.
I guess it's like when you make decisions, do you think you're like a rational decision maker, or because I know I'm pretty irrational.
Oh yeah. Really? No, I mean,
wait, Nicole, before you say, can I guess that you're a rational decision maker? Yeah. Okay, no. You can go.
No, really?
No, I've been trying to be more intuitive because I'm like, as a person, I'm more a feeler than a thinker, actually. So quite like many of my decisions, I kind of, it depends on my feeling for it. That sounds really weird. But what I mean by that is that mostly, like, whenever there's like something I need to decide, I already know, like, deep down what I'm leaning towards.
Right.
And this is kind of my feeling for it. Instead of, I'm always trying to rationalize things. And yeah. I'm always like trying to, oh, but
like post-rationalize, like after you make this decision.
Yeah,
as well.
But even beforehand, and then I'm like, oh, but I should go for this because rationally speaking, this is the best decision. But even though I don't want it and I don't see it like as the best thing for me in the moment. Yeah, so I've been trying to be kind of more intuitive. And I think from what I've like read about this, it often comes also down to just listening to your own thoughts and like to yourself, as you said, maybe not only the body, but also like, you know, being alone with your own thoughts, which is which can be quite difficult at times when like your head is like overthinking, and also like I feel like silence or like stillness helps in that, like maybe meditation or like yoga or just, you know, just listening. And quite often there is already like a tendency, at least for me, I just need to listen.
I feel like for Glory this is more apparent also when it's about whether people give you a good vibe or not. Like I feel like even though you're kind of rational when you make normal decisions, when it comes to like whether you like people, it's very like vibes.
I had this conversation with Yan Chan a few days ago, and I was saying like, oh, I really like this person because she gives me such like good vibes. Like, I feel like I can be friends with her. Like, it's very much in the first few minutes you meet this person, it's like that impression you get. But then like some people, like even though say I really want to be friends with them, but then if in the first few like minutes that I meet them, I feel like, oh, I don't feel like our energy aligns, then it's kind of sad, you know. But then I don't completely rule out, like it's not that, like I could be wrong, you know, because actually a lot of my friends from high school, like secondary school, I didn't click with them like the first time I met them.
Yeah,
it was like a few years later then we started becoming friends. So like my intuition could be wrong, but I feel like in university, because it goes,
you've already developed as a person, I feel. Yeah. Like you're already, yeah.
I think so. Yeah, I think that's a really good point. And also I feel like university passes by so quickly. Like I can't believe we're already like at the beginning of our final year. But I feel like, so I think I maybe like I trust my gut and intuition a bit more when it comes to like meeting new people. You know, I don't wanna try and waste time on like trying to be friends with people that I don't necessarily get good vibes from, like from the very beginning. I don't know if it's the same with you guys though. Yanshan, what about you?
I think I try to rationalize things as well. I think I'm like Nicole, like I try to post-rationalize a lot of things, so whether it's friendships or whether it's decisions, but I think I post-rationalize it though. Like I make the decision, then after that I think of reasons why I chose the decision, then I make sense in my head. And even if I make like a pro and cons list, I usually just choose the one that I was leaning towards anyway.
Yeah.
And I kind of know what's right for me. So for example, like even things which don't make sense, like coming back from to the UK from March to May, which is very random, it was like, oh, I need to go now, like I have to go because I just want to go so badly. And I don't even know why, like there's no pros, not there weren't many pros to be honest, so but it was like the right thing at the time.
Yeah, I think so. Sometimes you just can't really explain it, you know, but then like you know that you want it as well. Like I also wanted to make a point that like I feel like it's also like for us, like it's a privilege to be able to like listen to ourselves and like our gut, because I mean, I bring back the example we have for the previous episode, right? For summer, because I mean, ultimately I picked like my own interests over like going to an internship. And like, I feel like that's also like a type of privilege, you know, like not everyone can have the privilege to like listen to their gut, because it might not be like the decision what people would normally approve of. So like I feel like it takes a lot of like, as in you need a some degree of privilege to be able to like listen to your gut and like do the things that you actually like to do. Yeah,
that's definitely true. And I feel like, as you just said, it also requires a lot of courage sometimes, especially when you know it's like rationally not the right decision and people will kind of judge you for it, or you expect them to judge you for it.
Yeah,
like I remember during first year, I was part of this one society, and rationally it made all sense because I joined for like my interest reason, and it seemed like such a good opportunity to meet friends. But like my gut told me that I just really didn't enjoy it. Like I don't know, I just didn't click with the people, and I found it was a lot of hassle during, like, because it was my first term, and I just got used to like the workload and how I need to manage things in university in general. And so for me, it took up a lot of hours from my week. And so I came like back and I was like exhausted, and I really didn't like it, but I didn't have the courage to just quit. And then it took me like weeks until I finally kind of managed to say no and say like, I'm sorry, but I'm like dropping out of this. And after I did, it was just like this weight lifted from my chest.
Yeah.
And I feel like we need to all kind of learn this, just to say no sometimes when it just doesn't suit us. And it doesn't have to do anything with like the other people or just the thing in general. It's just, it's not right for us.
Yeah. I think that's really true, because I tend to be like a people pleaser and I want everyone to like me. Yeah. And
I was just about to say that I think Yanshan has some issues with saying no.
Yeah, but then it took a long time. Like I'm still not over it, but it takes a while. Like I guess I had a similar experience in year one, also with a club, but also even for stuff like going on dates and stuff, it's like, wow, it takes a really long time for me to like actually really like come to grips with the fact that I don't want to go anymore. It has to be at the point where I'd rather be by myself than see other people, you know. Yeah, so I guess like when you listen to your gut for a lot of things, it's also just listening to your body and thinking about what it wants. I think it's just really cool that all this still links into the research that you are trying to do, and like there's so much about ourselves that we don't know, not just like mentally but also like physically. Like I literally don't know like how my gut works or stuff.
Yeah, it's actually, I was gonna say, like Nicole really liked her research like journey over the summer, and like she listened to her gut for the fact that she liked doing research on gut health. But that was just a silly line that I wanted to put in. But yeah,
But Nicole, are you actually not an irrational? Are you actually not a rational thinker? Because you seem so rational.
Oh, thank you.
I also think she's a rational
I
thinker.
mean, I feel like I do think a lot about decisions and I try to rationalize them, but I think intrinsically I'm more intuitive, but I'm just like, I guess, developing that now. My
Right.
actually one of my mom's friends, she always says when she makes a decision and she really doesn't know, like one thing you can do is you take a coin and then you say, you know, the number is yes and then the other side is no, and then
Right.
you flip it, right? But you don't look, and then in that like split second that you flip it,
Oh.
you get like the tendency you're leaning towards, like which one you
Right.
want it to be, right?
Yeah.
Or like the other thing is, which is a bit more like, I guess, weird, you write it on like two pieces of papers and then you stand over them and then you see which one feels right.
That's cute. Yeah, I feel like we inherently know which one we're leaning towards, but like sometimes you just need to push it a little bit to
Yeah.
like actually admit it to ourselves that that's
Because
the
I guess
one.
we're all brought up to make decisions based on merit instead
Yeah.
of to follow your gut.
That's
So
true.
for example, like I guess some big turning points in my life would be like when I chose to go to A level college in Malaysia instead of Singapore, even though I could have gone for in Singapore like for free. But then I just don't know, I just didn't want to do it. Like stuff like that, and then or like you just chose to apply to this uni instead of this uni, and then it just felt right, even though you didn't really know what you were getting yourself into.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I think also, like, I think Yensha has this tendency to, like, after she made a decision, like, even though maybe she followed her gut, like, she still thinks about it, like, I guess it was rationalized. She's like, oh, but what if I should have picked the other one? Like, what if I picked the other
Oh,
one kind of
do y'all
thing.
not do that? Y'all don't
I do
ruminate?
that.
I was saying, like, I feel like you two do that. I never do that. I guess I'm lucky because
That's good.
yeah, I mean, even it's the thing with the summer holidays, right? Like, in the end, I picked my interest, and then at that moment, I was like, oh, great, like I finally made a decision, like the weight was lifted off my chest, and then I never thought about the other decision like ever again. It's the same for my uni. I came to UCL, I never thought about the other unis that I didn't pick
Wow.
after. So yeah, I guess I'm lucky.
Nicole thinks about it all the time.
Do you?
I mean, I think this is just me overthinking about everything, but I feel like I'm getting better though nonetheless. And I often think that it's sometimes even if you pick something and then you realize, oh, you actually don't like it, and you see this as, oh, you know, I've wasted my time. It's actually not, because you've gotten this experience and you've kind of taken something away from it anyways. And then you can still like switch your path. It's not as if, you know, you need to decide one thing now and then you just have to stick to it until you're 80. This is not how it works. And there's a lot
Yeah.
of like intercrossing in between and like changing paths, which I think is fine, because like for me at the beginning of the summer, I was like very thinking about, oh, what do I want to do after my bachelor? Because I apart from knowing that I want to do research, I really don't know like which direction to go into. And I
Yeah.
talked to a lot of people and my tendencies switched over the summer
Right.
of where I want to go and what I want to do. And I'm still unsure, right?
Yeah.
But I've just decided to, you know, try out
Like
different
roll with it.
things.
Yeah.
Yeah, go
Yeah,
with the
and like
flow.
apply for things that come up and just see where I land, because
Yeah.
right now I can't tell where I'm gonna be.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same for me. I think there's no right or wrong. It's just about like what feels right to you
Don't you feel
ultimately.
like your mind is like, sometimes I feel like my brain is smarter than me. Like, you know, if it will like think of like if I think of a, if I'm if I think of like a dis not decision, if I come up with a problem now, like what am I gonna do after uni? I don't know. Then I just put it on my like it's on a back burner, like it's already come up, and then my brain like thinks about it, and then eventually the answer like surfaces like by itself, you know?
Yeah, sometimes it does. I feel like
Yeah.
that too,
Yeah, like a
yeah.
magic eight ball. Like for example, like even for very small things, like oh, okay, it's like small thing, like I'm planning like my friend's having a birthday, her a birthday next weekend, so what are we gonna do? Then I was just like, oh, it'll come out of my brain, I'll think about it. But I won't have an answer straight away. I wouldn't even like write a list or anything. But then a few days later I'll come up with like an answer which I'm happy with.
Okay,
Yeah.
yeah.
Yeah, I have that
Yeah.
too, especially during like quiet moments when even like either like before I fall asleep when it's like really quiet, I'm not like thinking about anything, or like when I wake up, or like in my, I guess my subconscious mind is trying to tell me like when I wake up, and then I have kind of the answer and I'm like, oh, you know, we can try this.
Yeah, it usually happens like before you go to bed, or for me it happens when I'm walking alone on the street.
Yeah, happens when I'm at the gym, like, you know, in the zone.
No, that doesn't happen to me.
Oh,
I feel like when you're doing gym, you're so focused on the exercise, I don't have time to think.
Right.
So maybe Yen-chan's not, she's not present.
Not doing super present. Maybe.
Anyways, yeah, I think that's a good length. Nicole, do you have anything to add regarding like your experience, or, you know, closing notes of any sort?
I mean, I guess I would like to encourage whatever stage you're in, just try different things, and like, you know, don't be afraid to, I guess, go down a path and realize you don't like it, and just, you know, see where it leads you, and like, I guess, listen to your guts in that respect.
Yeah, and your gut has your back.
Yeah, and if you're interested, like, do some research on gut health, because I find it like very exciting.
Right.
And yeah,
I think personally for me, like, knowing people who want to do academia, or like who are very passionate about the subject in general, especially if it's not architecture, it's like so exciting, it's like so interesting.
Yeah, same.
And it's so cool that you like it so much, you know, because like, yeah, all the people that I know who are like passionate, most of them are about architecture, just because that's what I do.
Yeah, I think it's also, I don't know if it's rare, but I guess it's not like very, very common to find people who really, really like their subject. You know, even in UCL, like when I talk to people, like I don't feel the passion, I guess.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's really nice to talk to you, nice. Nicole.
So. Magical.
Thank you for having me on your cool podcast.
You're welcome. The cool kids.
We belong the cool kids. Yeah. Okay. So I hope that episode was interesting for you to listen. And we'll see you in the next one. Thank you so much for being here, Nicole. And yeah, bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.